Lecture 4, Populations versus Samples. Hi, in this lecture, we will learn about the differences between populations and samples. Slide 2, what is a population? In statistics, the term population has a special meaning that might differ from your commonsensical understanding of it. It might not if you've had a lot of stats courses already, but if you're new to statistics, this definition of population probably varies from what you normally think of. So, in statistics, a population refers to the entire group or system of individuals or elements that make up some group. This isn't really as complicated as it sounds. Let's look at some examples. What else? Be aware that individuals and elements, so both of those words, refer to the same thing. They refer to a single member of some population of things, whether they're animate things or inanimate things. Thus, we could be talking about individual whales, individual sand grains, or individual people. And if we wanted to refer to whales, sand grains, or people as elements, we could do that as well. Slide 3, population examples. Let's take 3 examples. If we talk about the population of, say, killer whales in the Pacific Ocean, we are referring to every single killer whale in the Pacific Ocean. If we talk about the population of sand on a specific beach, well, then we're referring to every single grain of sand on that beach. And if we talk about the human population of a given country, say Canada, we're talking about every single person in that country. So whenever we talk about populations in statistics, that population contains every individual or element that's in the group being discussed. Slide 4, advantages of populations. So, why do we care about populations, statistically speaking? It's really simple. Whenever we have population data, we have some kind of information on every individual or element in a given group. This means we do not have to guess about that information. So if we think back to the previous slide, we know exactly how many killer whales actually live in the Pacific Ocean. Likewise, we know how many grains of sand there are on that specific beach, or how many people live in a given country. Furthermore, in addition to knowing about the existence of each individual or element, we often know some other characteristics. We might know the age of each killer whale, the mineral composition of each grain of sand, or the age of each individual living in a country. Most of the time, when we have population data, we also have some specific kind of information about each element or individual. And this sort of makes sense. If you're going to go to the trouble of sort of tracking down every single element in a population, you probably just don't want to be able to name it Fred or Bob or sand particle 423 or Flipper the killer whale. You want to have some more information than just being able to name them. So, population data makes it easier to plan for the future or understand the present. I mean, that's the whole reason we're interested in collecting it. What else? Oh yeah, one more thing. Data are plural, whereas datum is singular, or at least that's how a lot of dictionaries define it. Though in North American English, this definition is broken down a lot, and so often you'll hear people say data for both the singular and the plural. Slide 5. However, counting a population is pretty difficult. As you may imagine, in the case of the 3 examples we've just had, it is costly in terms of time and other resources to count every single element in a population. For instance, how do you know you really counted all the killer whales? Could maybe have one been hiding in that undersea canyon over there that you never got around to going to? And what if there's a new one that's born while you're looking for all the older ones? Or conversely, what if it takes you so long to count them that like 5 or 6 of them die? So do you have to start over again? Likewise, how will you know you've gotten all the grains of sand on the beach? What about the ones that got swept out to sea just when you started to count the first grain? Do you still need to go track down the ones that got swept out to sea and count those? And what about the new grains that form while you're counting at the beach? You know, it could be that your footsteps on the beach are actually causing every now and then a couple of grains of sand to sort of form to, you know, a bigger grain breaks into two smaller grains. Do you count those? Do they still count as one? Now, does it count as two? And while you're doing all this counting, who's going to pay your bills? What happens if you sneeze and miss one of the grain stands? Or double count because the sun got in your eyes? Or, God forbid, because you've been looking at tiny grains of sand so long, you go blind. Of these three examples, counting people living in a country is the most common attempt at actually measuring a single population. And even this doesn't happen all that often because it costs so much. Counting all the elements in a population is known as conducting a census. Sometimes it'll also be called enumerating a census. This is an expensive, time-consuming activity. That's why Canada only does it every 5 years, why the United States only does it every 10 years, and why some countries like the United Kingdom are considering doing away with it altogether and relying on other data sources to sort of cobble together a de facto census. As a result of it being so costly to compile or conduct or enumerate a census, we often rely on sample data instead of population data. Slide 6, sampling as an alternative. The common solution to, well, the really replacement for, a census is just to take a sample. Fundamentally, a sample is some subset or part of a population. However, some samples are better at telling us about the characteristics of the population they belong to than are others. That is, some samples are more representative of their population than are other samples. In case it isn't clear, a more representative sample is preferred over a less representative sample. Slide 7. Samples are smaller than a population. Just to make this really clear, samples are really smaller than their population. If you take a sample that's so big that it includes everybody in the population, well, hey, presto, you just conducted a census. And why am I making this point about samples being smaller than a population? Well, I'm shocked by the number of students at the end of my stats course every year who still don't understand this. If you don't learn anything else in this class, learn that there's a difference between a sample and a population. One way to think about a sample, maybe to help you recall the difference between a sample and a population, is this example. Imagine a blood sample. When you're getting a blood test for something, like mononucleosis, the kissing disease, for instance, the hematologist, that's the fancy term for the person that draws your blood, the hematologist doesn't draw out every ounce of blood in your body, do they? No. They draw a sample. They take some of your blood and assume that the chemical properties of your blood that are contained in the sample, that those hold for the rest of the blood that's still left in your body. So they don't need to draw all your blood to figure out what the likely composition of your blood is. Like, do you have, for instance, lots of active white blood cells that would indicate that you have some kind of infection? They only need to take a sample. The thing to remember is that the way the sample is conducted or collected determines how likely it is to reflect the real underlying characteristics of the population from which the sample is drawn. In other words, how you draw a sample has important implications for how representative it is. Slide 8. Why do we care? We care about populations because collecting data on an entire population provides you with the richest information possible. Are there any 123-year-old killer whales in the Pacific Ocean? If you have population data on that population, and you also happen to figure out the age of every whale in the Pacific Ocean, you actually know. Either you do know it or you don't know it. So if you have population data, you could conclusively answer this question. However, collecting data on an entire population is expensive in terms of time and money, even when it comes to people, and furthermore, it might be impossible. I'm pretty sure it's really impossible to collect a census of killer whales, unless you learn whatever their various dialects are and can click and pop and make the sort of funky whale noises and spend many years, like say Jacques Cousteau, and sort of track the whales down and coordinate them, get them to really buy into the importance of a census. You're probably never really going to get a census, at least with current technology. in cases where it's just impossible to enumerate a population, for instance, in the case of killer whales, or grains of sand, from sort of practical terms, we rely on a sample as our estimate of the population's characteristics.